Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here, to very warmly welcome you here to the 2014 Beveridge Memorial Lecture. My name is Professor Roseanne Taylor and I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Veterinary Science. And before I proceed, I'd just like to begin by acknowledging and paying respect to the traditional owners of the land upon which we meet, and that is the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. It's upon their ancestral lands that the University of Sydney is built, lands where people have been sharing their learning, and interestingly, sharing their learning and knowledge of animals, our environment, and people and the relationships between them for probably 50,000 years or more. And that's a pretty inspiring thought. As we share our knowledge, teaching, and learning and research practices within our university, we pay respect to the knowledge embedded within the Aboriginal custodianship of our country. And I'd like you to take a moment to just pause and look to your left and right, and you can see a very distinctive way in which we're acknowledging and honouring the Aboriginal linkages to these lands. These are two new artworks which we were able to unveil this last week, purchased with funds from the Chancellor's fundraising committee. So they're beautiful pieces of artwork. Now, I'd like to start with an introduction to our lecture. Before I introduce our speaker, I'd like to tell you a bit about the Ian Beveridge Memorial Lecture. Now, Ian Beveridge was a pretty remarkable veterinarian. Emeritus Professor William Ian Beveridge was a veterinary alumnus of the University of Sydney who graduated in 1931. He was a pretty dynamic guy. His celebrated life was devoted to fighting disease, not only diseases of animals, but also the diseases that afflict humans. Whilst he began his career starting with foot rot and working in diseases in animals, particularly sheep, he spent some time at the CSIRO McMaster Laboratory, which stands just behind this building on our campus. He went on to take up a research fellowship in the USA. He worked at the Walter and Eliza Hall Institute, at the Pasteur Institute, and was dean at the University of Cambridge. I think the thing we particularly remember Ian for, and the reason that this lecture is named for him, is that he really got that idea of one medicine, the idea of the deep interconnections between human health and human well-being and animal health and animal well-being. And indeed, he devoted much of his career, particularly in the latter part, to working with the World Health Organization, working on diseases that affect both humans and animals. So this evening's lecture is entitled Bartonellosis, One Health Perspectives on an Emerging Infectious Diseases. And it will be presented by our esteemed guest, Professor Ed Breitschwerdt, who is here visiting us on a Beveridge with support from our Beveridge bequest and also with support from Bayer. And I'd like to particularly thank them for their support. Dr. Breitschwerdt is a professor of medicine and infectious diseases at North Carolina State University College of Veterinary Medicine. He's also an adjunct professor at the very well-recognized Duke University Medical Center and a diplomat of the American College of Veterinary Internal Medicine. Dr. Breitschwerdt directs the Intracellular Pathogens Research Laboratory in the Center for Comparative Medicine and Translational Research, a lovely facility on the Vet Science campus at North Carolina State University, which I've had the pleasure of visiting. He also co-directs the Vector-Borne Diseases Diagnostic Laboratory and is the director of the NCSU College of Veterinary Medicine Biosafety Level 3 Laboratory. Professor Breitschwerdt's clinical interests include infectious diseases, immunology, and nephrology. And for over 20 years, his research has emphasised vector-transmitted intracellular pathogens, which we'll hear about tonight. Most recently, he's contributed to cutting-edge research on human and animal Bartonellosis. In addition to authoring numerous book chapters, proceedings, research papers, in 2012, he received the North Carolina State University Alumni Association Outstanding Research Award, and in 2013, he received the Holliday Medal, the highest award bestowed on a faculty member at North Carolina State University. So it is my very great pleasure to welcome Professor Breitschwerdt to the stage to tell us more about his work, and please join me with a warm welcome.
Good evening, everyone. It's certainly a pleasure to be here. And when I hear that introduction, I remember what my sons say to me not infrequently, "Dad, when are you going to get a life?" I think I've had a pretty good life. And one of the highest honors that I've been afforded to date is to be invited to come halfway across the world to give this particular lecture. And I hope I do it justice. Dr. Taylor had asked me to make a few comments for the students as an introduction of how I managed to get here, and I'm going to limit that to just four slides. But I grew up on a farm in Maryland that was essentially a truck farm, cattle farm, and I was very fortunate that I had a dad with an eighth grade education and a mom with a high school education that decided four sons were going to college no matter what. And that's the reason that I ended up at a university. In regard to lessons I kind of learned along the way, one is never underestimate potential. And for those of us that work in the clinics, we know that every case that comes into that hospital, there is a potential research project actually attached to it, generally with no associated funding. In this instance, that dog that you see there with his tongue hanging out was about a six-month-old puppy that I took with me from the University of Georgia to the University of Missouri when I started my internship. He put me deeply in debt by eating most of my shoes while I was at work, but he turned into one of the best bird dogs that anyone would ever want and a companion for about the next 12 years of my life. And then when I ended up in North Carolina, along come two little blessings. One of which here you can see is helping to put in the flower beds at the new house, which was a necessity to be able to get the mortgage, and that's he and his little brother. This is some time later. Both the boys ended up playing recreational soccer, challenge soccer, and premier soccer, and this was after a game of the oldest one there, which I think is on your left. Brett, who was playing Division I soccer at his university at this point in time. So when nurtured, blessings can clearly grow. I think my most important message to the students is both attitude and aptitude are critically important, whether you're a clinician or a scientist. But at this stage of my life, I'm pretty well convinced that attitude is probably trumps aptitude. And only in as much as you really have to have a strong attitude to keep going when they don't fund your research, when they don't like your manuscripts, when the reviewers have problems with the fact that you're actually finding organisms in patients that people haven't found before. And so these pictures depict the fact that I think doing ironwork for about three or four summers, and I'm on the end of that Pico crane there. It's actually my father that you can see on the front end, and we're taking that down. We're about 27 stories up. So attitude and aptitude are both important. It probably was attitude that got me here because I'm not all that smart. So now for the topic. I think for the veterinary profession, this might be one of the most important genera of bacteria that we're going to have to worry about in the next decade or so. And there's clearly a lot more that we don't know about these bacteria than we do. What's medically important and relevant on this slide is the fact that they have an extremely slow dividing time. So that's the reason that microbiologists did not find these bacteria very readily in the blood of either animals or humans. The other relevant part clinically, I think, is the fact that initially in the mid-90s, all the researchers on Bartonella were looking at this organism like it was a Babesia or malaria organism because it resided within an erythrocyte, which is the electron micrograph here by Dorsey Cortic in my laboratory. But since then, I am not aware of a cell that a researcher is trying to infect with Bartonella, at least in vitro, that they've not been successful. And certainly these bacteria can get around the body substantially. Now, on an evolutionary basis, all of us as clinicians have a little trouble with these very complicated phylogenetic trees, but we're just going to worry about that upper left corner. And what you see is Bartonella is a kissing cousin to Brucella. Clinically, that's important because Bartonella is extremely difficult to diagnose, as is Brucella. And I think what we're learning is Bartonella is equally as hard to eliminate from a chronically bacteremic patient as Brucella. For the microbiologists in the audience, one of the more interesting aspects of Bartonella is the fact that it is very closely related to Agrobacterium tumefaciens, which uses a type 4 secretion system to inject its DNA into the plant genome to induce tumor production. And I'm pretty well predicting that Christoph Diejo's group in Switzerland will be publishing on the use of that type 4 secretion system to stick little chunks of Bartonella DNA into the human genome within the next couple years. So one thing about these evolutionary relationships is they can help clinicians to at least get a handle on what's going on, perhaps with these organisms when they're newly discovered organisms. And I apologize for my voice. Being an infectious disease guy, I managed to pick up one on the way over here. I was in great shape in Brisbane a week ago. My voice was in great shape until yesterday. And it's very close on the recovery phase, which is the reason that Dr. Malik sequestered me through the entire cocktail hour, which I thank him for. So otherwise, I'd have gotten in trouble. So Bartonellosis, the problem I've had with this over the last couple of years is that I've started to wonder whether Bartonellosis could be a hidden epidemic. And I've taken some solace in the fact that Aristotle said it's the mark of an educated mind that you can contemplate something without accepting it, and clearly that's where I am. But I would suggest to you that when bubonic plague killed a third of the European population, we didn't know it was a bacteria, we didn't know there was a rodent reservoir, and we didn't know that there was a vector in the context of the rat flea that was involved in transmission. And I think, you know, the question then would be, if this guy comes from America and he thinks there's a hidden epidemic, how in the heck can you hide an epidemic from really smart people? Well, one, you start with an unknown genus of bacteria, and before 1990, as we'll get to, Bartonella was not known to exist on the North American continent in an animal or a human. It behaves as a stealth pathogen, which is a term that I think was coined by Stanley Falco as the one of the past presidents of the American Society of Microbiology, essentially an organism that can fly under the radar and not be detected. The other problem for those of us in veterinary medicine is you need a large and diverse wildlife reservoir, which will develop that thought, and then facilitate transmission through multiple vectors and means, and that story just keeps getting more and more complicated as time goes on. So as I alluded to, if it were not for HIV, molecular techniques, and David Relman's ability to amplify bacterial DNA out of patients with either Pileosis hepatitis or bacillary angiomatosis, I wouldn't be giving this lecture today, and there's a good chance we would not know that these bacteria exist throughout a good portion of the world today, which we'll go on to. The other message that I want to share is the importance, again, of comparative medicine, One Health, and if we get down to the nitty-gritty, actually physicians and veterinarians working together to try to better understand disease and disease causation. So some 20 years after bacillary angiomatosis was associated with Bartonella infections, and it is the only bacterial infection that is known to cause bacillary angiomatosis or Pileosis hepatitis, we ended up describing a case in conjunction with Dr. Jaeger, who's a veterinary dermatopathologist, of a dog with bacillary angiomatosis. Similar to the human situation, this dog would have never developed this disease process if the internist had not been immunosuppressing the dog because of a bone marrow disease. And once this occurred, and once it was confirmed that the dog was infected with Bartonella and it was treated with antibiotics, both the bacillary angiomatosis and the bone marrow disease went away. Now, The other area that we're only going to touch on, but I think is perhaps one of the most important areas, and clearly there are entire reviews on what we know about Bartonella in the context of vaso-proliferative diseases and the pathological mechanisms that induce this. But from my standpoint as an internist that sees patients every day, what's fascinating to me is we can find the same bacteria in association with a tumor that has a very unusual biological behavior that's an hemangiopericytoma in dogs, wolves, and horses. And we can also find the same bacteria in humans with a very unusual tumor that's called an epithelioid hemangioendothelioma in the United States, in Australia, and in England. So one of the ways that, as you will see in a subsequent slide, that I think we could start looking at causation is looking at the biological behavior of these organisms across species, with humans only being one. And if we get, as we might say to our students, a match, a match, a match, that might have biological and medical relevance. So cat scratch disease was the next major association with Bartonella, and it was by Russ Rigneri, a rickettsiologist at the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. And there was an isolate made from an AIDS patient in Texas. Russ essentially used that isolate to prove that there were a lot of cats running around with the antibodies to this, then made an isolate from a cat, and then subsequent work pretty much proves that if you get cat scratch disease, it is due to Bartonella henselae, and there may be a couple other Bartonellas that do it, but the evidence there is very, very thin. So a single Bartonella became synonymous with cat scratch disease. Now, for the veterinarians in the audience, I use humans as my animal model for cats and dogs. I think it's fair if they use our cats and dogs and other animals for their models, then we ought to be able to go the other way. And again, all that means is we spend an awful lot of time reading the human literature, and there's some really fascinating human literature related to atypical cat scratch disease. And one of the pathologies that both AIDS patients get and children get, in particular with incompletely developed immune systems, is osteolytic lesions. And what you can see, this is from a 3.5-year-old cat who had a digit in the back leg cut off 18 months before these radiographs were taken. 18 months later, this cat now has a vasoproliferative lesion involving the metacarpal bone and a very severe osteolytic lesion in the middle of that radiocarpal bone. So we ended up getting involved because one of my students is now seeing this case. The conventional microbiological testing had not provided a solution, and what I can tell you is we ended up growing what we believe to be a canine-adapted Bartonella out of this particular cat. Mardula Variant, who is a veterinarian who did her PhD in my lab, was able to go back and get that digit from Antec Laboratories 18 months earlier and prove that we had Bartonella vincenii burkholderi DNA in it at that point in time. So we learned from this cat that cats don't do too well when they're infected with Bartonella vincenii burkholderi genotype 1, and that they can develop lesions that are indicative of atypical cat scratch disease in humans. And finally, that they can maintain this infection, apparently, for at least 18 months. So one of the first things that Dorsey Cordick did in my lab as a PhD student was to ask the question if cats A through S have induced neuroretinitis or classical cat scratch disease in patients 1 through 14, how long is this cat bacteremic and how long is it a risk to the people? And one of the things I don't like saying, but I do in these lectures now, is that everything we've found since we started doing Bartonella research is bad for cats, bad for veterinary medicine, and bad for the human companion animal bond. So what you can see is there's far too many pluses compared to the negative cultures. The techniques we were using at this point were lysis centrifugation techniques, so they were not near as sensitive as what we would use now. So some of those negatives may be true negatives, that the cat immunologically eliminated infection, and some of them may well be false negatives. But the bottom line is a cat that gives you cat scratch disease can remain infected for 12 to 18 months, But the good news is if you keep the fleas off the cat, there's a good chance that it is unable to transmit that infection. The other interesting thing that Dorsey found was that cats, like humans, presumably, and like experimentally infected rodents, develop a relapsing pattern of bacteremia as depicted by the rib bars. For those of us microbiologically, this is a disaster because what it basically means is the bacteria is in the blood, it's out of the blood, it's in the blood, it's out of the blood. And although I show you one of 14 cats in this study, some of the cats, it was out of the blood for 3 months, and then we cultured it and got it again. So we thought that cat had eliminated the infection where it had not. The other interesting part for the veterinary practitioners and internists in the audience is if you have an animal with undetermined cause for eosinophilia, Bartonella induces an eosinophilia in SPF cats following blood transfusion in the laboratory, and it also does that in dogs. So at least in our country, once we rule out hookworms, roundworms, whipworms, and heartworms, Bartonella might become a consideration. So after Rignery made his association with cat scratch disease, veterinary researchers around the world started establishing the prevalence. And this isn't serologic prevalence. This is actually the prevalence of bacteremia based on culture. And what you can see is that that prevalence is extremely high. The good news coming from laboratories predominantly in Europe in the last year or two is that the isolates of Bartonella henselae that are readily made from cats are not typically the isolates that are found in humans that develop cat scratch disease. So I think the analogy that we can use is that Bartonella henselae has a tremendous spectrum in regard to strain variation and virulence, with some strains, if you will, being like E. coli 0157, but the majority of strains being like the E. coli that's in my intestinal tract, which hopefully isn't going to cause me any problems. But what you can see is a fairly high prevalence of bacteremia, and certainly with this newer information, we as veterinarians are going to have to revisit some of our literature and our thoughts. So, AIDS, cat scratch disease, and within a year, Bartonella had never been associated with endocarditis in any human anywhere in the world. Three case reports. One, Bartonella quintana, the trench fever agent with the human body louse. We've actually cultured Bartonella quintana from cats. The French have PCR'd it out of fleas, and Bruno Schimmel and Davis has PCR'd it out of ticks. So although there is a louse-human association that is extremely strong and longstanding, there's a few other ways that Bartonella quintana is playing around out there in nature. Bartonella elizabethae in rats and Bartonella henselae in cats. I'll just call your attention to Mayotinensis at the bottom of this slide. For the last 2 years after this was described, or three, I would say, all right, the Mayo Clinic found a Bartonella, amplified it, sequenced it from the heart valve of a patient. We know the patient did not have a travel history out of the Minnesota, Wisconsin area, but we don't know the reservoir and we don't know the vector. Emerging infectious diseases last month, the likely vector is bats. So we now know the vector, and what I'm not going to talk about tonight because I can't keep up with them is that they are naming a new Bartonella species in bats on almost a weekly basis, and I know bats seem to be a bit of a problem every once in a while here in Australia. The other thing from that slide that I think is important is that as you looked at the species, we've got the same Bartonellas in dogs as we do in humans. So in the United States, there's been a lot of debate, does Bartonella ever cause disease in a cat? And what I can tell you is both in the laboratory now, it can kill cats due to myocarditis, and in nature, which is what we publish because we try to spend most of our time studying natural disease, it can kill cats due to myocarditis. We've also described myocarditis in dogs, and there are some suggestions, particularly in the Swedish literature, that Bartonella may be involved in human myocarditis. This is clearly an area in which there needs to be a lot more work, because if persistent bacteremia occurs and people can have subclinical myocarditis and it can result in death, that's something that is very important. So As a veterinary internist, I've come to believe that cats are not typical of any other species on the planet and don't develop any disease that looks like any other species on the planet, but the dogs do. And what dogs do immunologically is if you give them rickettsia or ehrlichia or babesia or Bartonella, they like to do the same type things that people do. So I think in regard to trying to understand how Bartonella is behaving out there for me as an internist, I wanted to start understanding what Bartonella was doing to our canine patients. And the pluses here are not on the basis of extremely strong evidence base. Some of it's case series, some of it's case reports, some of it's serologic associations. But if I had to put in paragraphs, which I've tried to do, what Bartonella is likely doing, it is clearly doing piliosis hepatis, bacillary angiomatosis, endocarditis, myocarditis, cranialomatous disease in lymph nodes, liver, and other tissues. The encephalitis, ITP, and IMHA are softer. So over time, I got pretty excited about dogs and Bartonella, and I would present a lot of case reports, and my peer group would say, well, Ed, how do you know this thing's actually causing these diseases? And it's not that you're just developing tools that you can find them better. And I thought about that for quite a while, and it ended up being this paper, which was about 4 or 5 years of writing on airplanes or in hotel rooms. As my sons have said, Dad, when are you going to get a life? But I, again, think this postulate, similar to Cook's postulates, doesn't absolutely prove anything, but it's a tool that we can use as scientists to try to implicate that these bacteria involved. And again, I'd refer you to the reference. So now I know we've got some people that are interested in ticks and fleas and vectors, and we're going to spend a little bit of time on vector biology. Just because if someone after this lecture knows of any pathogen in the world that's transmitted by more vectors, please send me an email and let me know. We know for sure sandflies transmit Bartonella bacilliformis in South America. We know the human body louse is primarily responsible for trench fever in World War I and transmitting Bartonella quintana in probably every inner city that occurs where there are indigent, alcoholic, homeless people throughout the world, which again, we didn't know until AIDS in 1990. Bartonella henselae transmitted by the cat flea, Bartonella, as we'll come to that in a minute, rodent fleas, corn flies, and cattle. So on my farm, 80% of the beef cattle have Bartonella bovis in their blood, at least the one time we did that study. Probably ought to go back and check again. It's probably 100% now, and techniques are a little better. Also, what seems to be true, and there certainly needs to be some more definitive research done in this area, is that Bartonella is able to be transmitted directly through a bite of a tick or perhaps a sandfly, or indirectly through a host that enhances the number, increases the number of bacteria, deposits them in the feces, and then we manage to scratch and inject Bartonella, or a cat manages to get contaminated flea feces, scratch us, and inject the Bartonella. Regardless, once it gets below the skin, it seems like it's picked up by dendritic cells or other macrophages. It's carried to the endothelium, and it sets up shop in the endothelium. The Bartonella researchers refer to the primary niche, and there's different camps in regard to whether the primary niche is the endothelium, whether it's the bone marrow. I think there's probably more than one primary niche, and it probably is the bacteria cares about it less than we do as researchers. Regardless, it ends up in the blood, out of the blood, as we alluded to earlier, which is a concern diagnostically. This, and I'll show you on the next slide, the essence of this, but this is a manuscript published last year, and one of the problems we've got now is we're finding situations in nature where other vectors seem to be involved in the transmission. So this story started with this mother at 2 o'clock in the morning who found my name by Google on the internet. And she pursued Mr. Google to the extent that she ultimately read some papers and got in touch with me. And the reason she did is she was seeing a neurologist, her oldest son was seeing a neurologist, but most importantly, her youngest son had Guillain-Barré syndrome that had progressed to chronic demyelinating polyneuropathy. And despite the fact that the pediatric neurologist, who is a co-author on this paper, was increasing the interval, or decreasing the interval and increasing the number of IVIG administrations, this little boy was going from being clumsy going upstairs to no longer being able to climb upstairs. To make a long story short, all three of these individuals had Bartonella henselae in them, as did these little roly-polies, wood lice, as did some wood lice hunter spiders that were collected around this apartment by the father a year and a half later. So one of the nice things about molecular testing, and again, assuming that you have all your controls and you have no contamination, which I like to think we do, and this story started when the family lived in this apartment, a flood came, the apartment was flooded, they ended up with an infiltration of these guys in the walls, and then he ended up with these guys because they like to eat these guys. And then she, fortunately, which is in the manuscript, took pictures of the bite wounds on her two children. And we believe that's how transmission occurred. Obviously, there could have been other means. So I am not sure that being a veterinarian is the best profession in the world, but it's the one that I've clearly enjoyed the most. And I've enjoyed it because being a veterinarian to me is represented by this beautiful picture by this Spanish artist. And it really is the essence of what I went into the profession for. And what I can tell you is Bartonella has ruined that. And it's ruined it because ground squirrels, gray squirrels, flying squirrels, and groundhogs in North Carolina are all infected with a different Bartonella species. You see where I'm going? So, and we are over 32 named species now. We have one in our lab that we've gotten out of dogs, we've gotten out of humans that doesn't have a name. And this is another example of two isolates that we had in the lab for 2 years before Michael Kosoy, who's a CDC vector biologist and Bartonella researcher, published sequences saying sheepkids or wingless flies have a Bartonella sequence in them. And then David Bemis, who's a veterinary microbiologist at the University of Tennessee, published sequences where he got blood in from sheep, poured his plates, put it in the incubator, and had bacteria grow on it before he put a patient sample on it. So obviously that was a problem. Bemis was smart enough to sequence that problem, and his sequence matched Michael's sequence, which matched our sequence. If you look at atypical cat scratch disease, what you will find is pericarditis and pleural effusions are manifestations of a small number of people with what is historically called, and I don't like the term cat scratch disease, Bartonellosis. So one of the most important messages for the veterinarians and the physicians, the medics in the audience, is that historically we have not considered fleas as a vector for pathogens. We've considered fleas as obnoxious little parasites that cause dogs and cats to scratch and cause allergy in a subset of those dogs and cats. These fleas, the cat flea, that in our country coexists with raccoons, possums, coyotes, skunks, dogs, and cats, so Tenosophales felis is on all of those, is actually carrying five different Bartonella species potentially and may be vector competent for the transmission of all of them. So clearly one of the things that's become important is to kill fleas, kill fleas, kill fleas. But the other thing is to educate young veterinarians that fleas pose a risk to animal health as well as human health. And this is a study by Mike Lappin's group from Colorado State University, and in a laboratory setting where you infect four cats with culture-grown Bartonella, and you put fleas on those cats, and you put product on one group, you don't put product on the other group, you can prove that you can protect cats if they are not allowed to get on the cat and bite, compared to about 60% that became infected. Now, when I give my lectures to the third-year students, the first lecture in infectious disease, I say, Infectious diseases are not important. Very first sentence, I've done it for several years now. And if anybody shows up to that lecture, I actually pause for a little bit and see whether they're paying attention or they're ordering shoes or what might be going on behind that computer. And then I say, infectious diseases aren't important unless it's your mother, your father, your child, your dog, your cat, or actually your patient that you're responsible for, and usually they start to get it. And again, if this is your daughter, then this becomes important. This is another phone call from a mother. You know, mothers found Lyme disease in the United States, and now it doesn't surprise me because they are the ones that can consistently find me and ask me, could this be possible? And so this is a young lady, again, published in the Journal of Clinical Microbiology, and she had been seeing several physicians in conjunction with a neurologist, psychiatrist, and neuro-ophthalmologist. She ends up being infected with Bartonella cholerae, and the story is when we first saw her, we were not doing cholerae serology. We had cat cholerae isolates in the lab, but we were only testing human samples for Hensolae, Vinsoniae burkhoffii, and Quintana, and she was negative to all three. What you can see is Ricardo Maggi, the scientist in the lab that's done all the human testing, got a positive PCR, but we were never able to sequence it. So we actually reported it out as a negative because unless we could put a DNA sequence on any PCR amplicon that we got out of a human patient, in my lab that was negative. So I did inform the ID physician that had become responsible for the child that we got an amplicon, we can't sequence it, I don't know what it means, she doesn't have antibodies. When we developed the IFA test, and we were going back and screening a bunch of folks, including veterinarians, lo and behold, she had antibodies. We contacted the ID physician, we got new samples, and by enrichment culture, you can see this was BK with a very specific new set of primers. And that's one of the messages for veterinarians is a negative PCR is just what it is. It's a negative PCR. It never proves that an animal is not infected with a given infectious agent. These are great tests, they're highly sensitive tests, but they too have a sensitivity and specificity. This is again a published paper. She failed doxycycline rifampin twice, finally responded to therapy. And all of her signs resolved. We're now 3 years down the road, and she just graduated as a senior from North Carolina State University. Tick transmission. This has became very controversial. I was interested in one of our PhD students doing a review because between 95 and 2005, there was serologic evidence, there was epidemiologic evidence, and it seemed like it was possible that ticks, and there were case-based evidence both in dogs that we were seeing as well as some humans. And then some French veterinarians using a somewhat complicated model suggested to the world that Bartonella hensolae was being transmitted by Oxotis rhesensis, and that didn't go over too well with the vector biologists. There were a lot of letters to the editor and criticism, but in Palos neglected tropical pathogens in the laboratory in a controlled model, we do know that it can occur. What we don't know is that if any dog, any human's ever been infected by a tick at this point anywhere in the world. But yesterday on one of the listservs I'm on, another manuscript just came out using mass spec and sequencing that basically says the same thing as Kemp's paper was a focus paper where he looked at ticks using 16S, sent us the DNA, we confirmed his observations targeting another gene. And if you go from northern Germany to southern Germany, you can find a lot of ticks infected with Bartonella hensolae in southern Germany and none in northern Germany, and it gets even worse in France and Spain. And then using next generation sequencing, again, a veterinary researcher at their division of agriculture, Bartonella is one of these unexpected pathogens. Excuse me. So I like being a clinician. I like seeing patients. And if you're really lucky in your career, you'll have more than one patient that actually will change your life, change your career, and change the direction of your research. I wish they came along with a check or a grant or something, but that doesn't usually occur at the time. And that was the case with this dog. This was the first dog we ever cultured for Bartonella. We cultured this dog for Bartonella because those three papers had been published in 1993 on endocarditis in humans. I had a PhD student in the lab doing a whole bunch of cultures on cats. And this dog had a 9-month history of progressing from polyarthritis to weight loss to seizures to vasculitis that was biopsy proven as a leukocytoclastic vasculitis to developing nosebleeds. And again, for the medics in the audience, I would bet next month's paycheck that there are some children out there that are infected with Bartonella that have defective endothelium in their noses, because it certainly doesn't seem to be associated, at least in dogs with platelet numbers or platelet function, that develop epistaxis. And if you look in the human cat scratch disease literature, you will find a subset of children that have epistaxis reported in association with their cat scratch disease. We've also published a series of dogs in J.Clin Micro that were culture proven with epistaxis that had different Bartonellas. At any rate, by the time we got the dog, it had developed endocarditis involving the aortic valve and the mitral valve. If the veterinarian had not been treating this dog for systemic lupus erythematosus, and if the veterinarian had not given more and more immunosuppression as the dog kept getting worse and worse, we would have never made an isolate from this dog, because the next PhD student in the lab spent 5 years and got one more isolate out of a dog with an hemangioparasitoma, despite doing about 400 dogs trying to make isolates. However, she did develop a very nice IFA, and this is Bartonella henselae. This is Bartonella vinsonii burkhoffii, which is a little larger. Both of these are in a cell culture system, the DH82 dog canine continuous monocytic cell line. So to try to get us to a closer point of ending this story for you tonight, we spent several years trying to understand Bartonella in dogs, and what we figured out was if you found a dog that had Bartonella antibodies, you couldn't find Bartonella DNA unless the veterinarian immunosuppressed the dog. So some of our meningoencephalitis cases, we could get a positive PCR out of blood. Some of our polyarthritis cases, we could get a positive PCR, but we still couldn't get an isolate with lysis centrifugation techniques. So Sushama Santaki was a postdoc in the lab at that point in time. I actually almost had a little black hair at that point in time. And in a lab meeting, when we were talking about the fact that we kept finding Bartonella being transmitted by more and more insect vectors, we asked the question, will it grow in an insect biochemical composition media better than a mammalian growth media? And the answer to that question in multiple publications that I'm not going to share with you tonight was yes. So the North Carolina State University biotech group decided, gee, that's pretty neat. And to my amazement, no one had ever considered using an insect growth media to try to grow bacteria diagnostically out of a dog or a horse or human. And so they slapped a patent on that with Sushama and myself. Another long story that I won't bore you with is the development of a company. And the reason that company exists is I knew the vice president for research, who used to be a Duke faculty member with Beck and Dickinson. I've worked with a number of diagnostic companies, including Abbott, IDEX, and Antech. And I couldn't get anyone to invest $30,000 in a technician to see if this would work. And so ultimately, through a somewhat contorted story, my oldest son was in law school doing a business class. They put a business plan around this. He went off to do environmental law, and I ended up with a company that's devoted to a single genus of bacteria at the beginning of a recession that most people can't spell. Also, with kind of one of the most complicated diagnostic platforms short of mycobacterium diagnosis that probably exists out there. So Ashley Duncan, another PhD student in the lab working with Ricardo Maggi, we then looked at 150 consecutive dogs going through the hospital with disease that we thought might be compatible with Bartonella. What you can see is for every sample, we extract DNA, do PCR, put it in enrichment culture. For dogs and humans, 7 and 14 days of incubation and then doing PCR works pretty well. The last graduate student, Natalie Cherry, did horses. We have never, except once, gotten a positive PCR out of a horse if we didn't incubate for 21 days. So horses apparently do a better job of suppressing this bacteria than dogs or humans, and we do a lot better job than cats seem to do, because if you want an isolate, just go find a stray cat out there tomorrow, and you've got a 1 out of 3 chance of that cat having one or more Bartonellas in it. So once we generated the BAPGM platform, and once we started using it in dogs, and once we started getting some useful results that would go with our serology or necropsy, I would have veterinarians come up and say, will you test me? And obviously the initial answer to that question was no, I will not, no, I cannot. But after a while of hearing the same question repeatedly in conjunction with Chris Woods, an infectious disease physician and good friend at Duke, we got IRB approval at Duke and North Carolina State University to start doing studies. And the most recent one was published yesterday in Vector-Borne Zoonotic Diseases, saying statistically, if you're a sick veterinarian, if you're Bartonella bacteremic with this platform, you're a sick veterinarian, you are not a healthy veterinarian. So there's multiple papers, we're not gonna cover all of them. This is an example of a veterinarian on our faculty, weight loss, to the point that the rumor mill amongst the faculty, does this guy have HIV or cancer? We have actually seen dogs worked up by veterinary internists, very good hospitals, very comprehensive workups, with nothing but weight loss. And all the testing was negative, and one of those dogs, at least from Texas that I remember very clearly, we grew Bartonella henselae out of, and it got a lot better after that. And I get a nice picture every Christmas from the owner. Poorly defined vascular lesion on the MRI. The daughter had been pulled out of school about 2 weeks earlier for headache, muscle pain, and insomnia. The father's history was about 9 months. He was being seen at the University of North Carolina Medical School. We're very fortunate in North Carolina that we've got 3 medical schools. One's at Duke, one's at UNC, and the other's a medical school too. It's at NC State. We call it the College of Veterinary Medicine. So what you can see here is that we were very lucky that Ricardo was able to get an amplicon sequence it directly out of the blood because enrichment culture failed, and that is not unusual. Fortunately, we went back with the neurology group over at UNC. They obtained blood and CSF, and I'm not showing you the serology results in this instance, but this patient had sky-high antibodies to both Bartonella henselae and Bartonella vinsonii burkholfi, and you can see both enrichment cultures were positive. What we've seen several times, and we've seen this both in dogs and humans, is that if an individual is co-infected and you treat for one Bartonella, then on subsequent testing, you end up finding the other one. And don't ask me why, but it would obviously be something that would be interesting for someone to look at in the laboratory. But I can tell you they had 5 cats in this household, and they were all feral, stray, rescued cats, and 4 of the 5 had Bartonella henselae, Houston 1. Houston 1 is not the typical strain that we tend to see either in dogs or in humans. And this is the results on the daughter. And again, I'm proud of this in as much as I would bet you if you sent her blood and serum samples to my lab, which was negative, to CDC or to the Mayo Clinic, everybody was gonna say she's PCR negative and she's not infected. But what you can see through enrichment culture, and we were fortunate enough to actually get an isolate from her, is that she was infected, and she was infected with the same subspecies and genotype that her father was infected with. So after that, we started looking a little more seriously at neurologic disease. And on this particular slide, this is not a veterinarian, 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 and son of a veterinarian. HIML means headache, memory loss, and insomnia. You can see that most of these individuals are female. Most of them are very young to middle age. And I'm just gonna highlight the one young lady that was number one, who's the non-veterinarian from this particular manuscript. And the reason is she had a diagnosis of cat scratch disease by a dermatologist 18 months before she started with minor motor seizure, petit mal seizures, but then she had progressed to generalized seizures, and then she had progressed to status epilepticus. So what you can see, and the serology at this point was being done by William Nicholson at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So these, when Our first several manuscripts were done in collaboration with rickettsiology and special pathogens group down there, and that's CDC serology, not ours. But these results are ours from PCR and sequencing by Ricardo. What you can see here is that she was from South Carolina. The infectious disease physician refused to treat her on the basis of the results that were generated. I didn't know that, but 256 days later, her mother contacted me. She went back to Duke. Despite communications that should be perfect between veterinarians and physicians, Duke managed to get CSF, but no blood, no serum. And the good news was, from her cerebrospinal fluid, we were able to enrich, PCR amplify, and sequence the same Bartonella that we had gotten out at day zero and day 31. Again, she was treated by Chris Woods, and the last time I talked to her mother, she seizured immediately after getting put on antibiotics very badly, did not seizure for about a year and a half after that. So this is a review article. It's written with a human pediatric neurologist that's worked with us on several patients now. And we put this together to try to take the human cat scratch disease cases and put them with our few BAP-GM cases and say, Houston, there may be a problem out there. And NIH, maybe you should be funding some research relative to neurobartonellosis. And I can assure you that has not happened yet. But that was the intent with this particular review article. And you'll see one case of fatal encephalopathy. The problem right now is physicians or medics are not likely to ask the question, were you scratched by a cat 6 months, 18 months, 10 years ago? Not likely to ask, have you had a flea infestation in your family and did anybody experience flea bites? And those are questions that I think we're going to have to ask in the future. So human perinatal transmission, I always say this is the most disconcerting thing that we've stumbled across and published. Again, another phone call from a mother. At this point, she was calling because she was sick, her husband was sick, and her son was sick. I'm not going through all the illness stuff. But what was amazing here, and again, the human pathologist that did the autopsy on the daughter is a co-author on this manuscript, provided the paraffin blocks, and we actually tested one paraffin block of tissue once a week for 5 weeks to be able to prove, to the extent that's humanly possible, that the results that we generated were not a laboratory phenomena, but a patient phenomena. And what you can see is that twin to this 10-year-old boy 10 years later that we grew Bartonella vinsonii burkholfi and Hensley out of his blood had the same genotypes and the same Bartonella Hensley strain as did the mother and as did the son. The father was only infected with vinsonii burkholfi by our testing at least, and it's likely that this mother became infected in New York from a feral cat about 20 years before this all started, if that story is correct. We've been involved in two large case studies. One is rheumatology patients. Again, this was a phone call actually from a physician on a Friday afternoon who is male. And Dr. Mosiani said, Ed, I've read a few of your papers and I want you to test some of my patients, to which I said no. After we talked a little bit, he hooked me because he said, Ed, I actually believe that some of these rheumatologic diseases that we see have an infectious basis, which is a state-of-the-art lecture that I gave at the College of Veterinary Internal Medicine meeting about 6 or 8 years ago that no one remembers. But 296 patients. Patient two is essentially starts with the very first patient that we started testing after the veterinary lectures. So you can see 192 patients that are predominantly veterinarians, veterinary spouses, veterinary technicians, and animal workers. And then population number three were Duke medical students and Duke physicians that volunteered to give blood for us to do both serology and BAP-GM. And I understand they had to pay these guys to get some of these blood samples. But the reality is all the 32 were negative by BAPGM enrichment culture PCR. Only one had an antibody to Bartonella henselae. About 40% had an antibody to Bartonella vinsonii Burkholfi genotype 2, which I do not think reflects exposure to that organism because there were no antibodies to genotype 1, there were no antibodies to genotype 3. But somebody ought to figure out why that reactivity occurs and whether we could repeat that in another cohort of physicians. At least as I was a physician, I'd like to know the answer to that question. And what you can see in these two studies, if we just go down here, is that Bob Mosiani was able to find a higher seroprevalence in his patients that he selected on the basis of an increased C-reactive protein or what he refers to as small vessel disease, resulting in either neurologic or rheumatologic manifestations. He had a higher prevalence of DNA that could be sequenced than we did if we looked at the veterinary group. In Paul Lanta's paper that was just published, the percent here is 28% compared to 24%, and it's a totally different study population. So this is the last slide, and one of the things that I say to my colleagues over at Duke is that if you want to find novel infectious agents, look in animals. If you want to figure out what they're doing, look in humans. Regrettably, the humans they ought to be looking in are the ones, some of which are sitting in this audience, because I believe we're going to be the best sentinels by which our physician colleagues will actually understand what Bartonella is doing out there in nature. I was asked about 3 years ago, and again initially said no, to be on a master's student committee in Grenada. Not that someone wouldn't want to go to Grenada, and not that someone wouldn't want to spend time in Grenada, but you would actually have to have a life to want to do that. And after meeting this student at the College of Internal Medicine meeting, she was a young, very enthusiastic surgeon, I said yes, which is what I seem to always do. So migraine, seizure, status epilepticus. This is a great case report to read because, one, this young lady seizured in the JFK airport. I went through JFK on the way to Norway not too long ago, and I wouldn't want to go through there with a couple drinks in me, much less seizure in the middle of the JFK airport. She also developed status on Grenada, and they've got a hospital right there with a veterinary school, and they medevaced her off to Trinidad, and she was in a phenobarbital-induced coma for about 14 days before they could get her out. So initially, and what I want to call your attention to is when we first tested her, she was negative for Bartonella. So 4 blood sample sets, 16 PCRs, everything's clean negative. And I say to Ricardo Maggi, throw every primer set we've got and see if you get anything, which yielded anaplasmic platelets. Anaplasmic platelets is a veterinary organism that's in brown dog ticks, which is in your indigenous communities here, and is likely in some people as well, because she is now not the only person that we've gotten anaplasmic platelets out of. So she was retested. She was also infected with a hemotropic mycoplasma that's likely transmitted by the same brown dog tick, Rhipicephalus sanguineus, Candidatus mycoplasma hematoparvum, which has a worldwide distribution as well. Because we found these two, we got a new set of 4 samples and 1 14-day culture yield Bartonella henselae. She was treated with 6 months of doxycycline, failed to clear and was PCR positive. She's subsequently been treated by our physician in South Africa with doxy and rifampin. And similar to the young lady that I told you, she got married in Christmas and has not seizured for a very, very long period of time. So I consider Bartonellosis, if not the most important problem for One Health, it's certainly one of the most important problems. It's important because there's too many vectors. It's important because there's too many reservoirs, and it's important because it's causing things that are much more subtle, much more insidious than endocarditis, which we can all believe is caused by this bacteria. Again, it's been an absolute privilege to be asked to give this lecture. It's been an honor to come here. I appreciate the hospitality that I've been afforded in the week I've been here. I got another couple weeks in Australia, and I'm looking forward to shaking hands with a couple of kangaroos. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Breitschwerdt. That's an excellent presentation on One Health, highlighting the value of integrating animal and human health. We do have time for some questions, so do we have some questions? Maybe the first one is, when are we going to see Bartonella Breitschwerdt?
It's possible. And I actually told the people in my lab it should not and would not happen, but one of the PhD students that I co-mentored went to Michael Kosoy's lab. Michael Kosoy's lab is working with these bats in Africa that hang trees, and there's a lot of them upside down, and they have a Bartonella.
With your name on it.
And it's been rumored. Nobody will be able to spell it, so it won't be a problem.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Dr. Nairi Jodd. I'm a medic, and we do have patients with these syndromes. We have a battle with our medical colleagues in prescribing long-term antibiotics for these patients. Do you have any idea of the length of treatment of some of your human subjects?
So one thing that I try to keep a very clear dividing line is I can treat all the animal species on this planet except one. And I do not at any point give information through publications, internet, or what have you. I refer them on to a physician that can provide that information. I will tell you that we biased our selection of our initial case reports for treatment successes because we were pretty sure we were going to have enough trouble getting this published as it was. If you look at some of the subsequent case reports, it's a little disconcerting because there's one in Jaclyn Micro where that veterinarian was treated for a year with antibiotics, and at 3 months, 6 months, and 9 months, he was culture negative, so we followed that guy for almost 4 years, but at 1 year, he was positive again for the same Bartonella that we had gotten out of him previously. At a time when everyone in this room is worried about antimicrobial resistance, at a time when we're all worried about the intelligent use of antibiotics, this bacteria is a problem. The good news is there's a lot of really smart young people in here, and Bartonellas have bacteriophages in them. There might be a better way of killing these bacteria than antibiotics. But if, again, you can just look at the case reports that are published. They're published with ID physicians and us doing the microbiology. And this is not an easy bacteria to treat. It's going to be analogous to Brucella, Coxiella.
John?
Ed, do you feel like there's any amongst this legion of different species that is better adapted and more problematic in humans than others? Because obviously, as you pointed out, every time you look at a new ectoparasite and a new mammalian species, you find a new Bartonella Breitschwerdtii or something. So I guess, do you feel like some of the ones you listed, like the ones you described in dogs, for example, are better adapted to humans and things that medical people should be looking out more for? Because obviously the diagnostics are a big challenge.
So I want to thank John Iredale because we met by internet across a very large expanse of ocean, and he is the co-author on the manuscript that describes the patient with epitheliodemangio endothelioma from Australia, and he's the attending physician for that patient, and he's certainly someone that has embraced One Health, at least in his communications with me. So answering your question, one of the things that's pretty clear is that we have created a platform that is better at finding Bartonella henselae, Bartonella benzoniae burkhoffii than it is at finding rodent Bartonella species. And although we can take culture-grown organisms and show the BAP-GM with kinetic growth curves and real-time PCR behaves, very similarly with 6 or 7 different Bartonellas that we tested 10 years ago. In the laboratory, I'm pretty sure that if you're dealing with patient samples in very small numbers, we're selecting for ones that we've optimized the media because it grows it great out of a cat, it grows it great out of a dog, and guess what, it'll grow it great out of humans. What I would wonder, and and I think it's really important because, you know, we've got sheep Bartonellas, we've got this Meatenensis, which now looks like a bat Bartonella. I didn't mention it, but Bartonella alsetica is a rabbit Bartonella, and the French found it in humans with endocarditis. They then found it in humans with granulomatous lymphadenitis, and these were people that hunted rabbits or butchered rabbits. So I think both in your country and our country, the major question is, how often are these really difficult to find Bartonellas? They're all hard to find, that make the jump out of a sheep into a human, out of a rabbit into a human. So there, you know, there's a lot of different answers to your question, and that's just one approach of trying to answer it, John, because I think it's partly that we develop tests that are more selected for the ones we're finding, and they just happen to be the ones that are in my patients as a veterinarian, and they're in the veterinarians that take care of those patients.
Helen?
Helen Scott Hall. I just wondered, you mentioned that the Bartonella has really come up in humans with the AIDS crisis, and obviously immunosuppression is a big thing. I'm wondering how much effect the host immune response has on the expression of these different Bartonella, and whether there is any underlying research going on the relationship between the pathogen and the host, especially in humans, and these different organisms that may be terribly long-term co-adapted to the different host species, whether it's rabbits or cats or whatever, or fleas, and then how that would relate to diagnosis in humans.
So to answer your question, I'll try to get all three of them, I think. In regard to Bartonella and immunosuppression, there's a beautiful manuscript in the American Journal of Pathology, and I think it's 1992, 1993, where a pathologist basically said, and I've got a slide that I didn't of it that I use in lectures that I didn't include, but that most people, most veterinarians that get a scratch from a cat that's covered with fleas may get an inoculation granuloma, immunologically the organism's handled, into the story. There's a subset of people. The next thing down in that graph is the people that develops cat scratch disease. So you get the granuloma, you get the fever, you get the lymphadenopathy, and then probably immunologically, in the vast majority of people, the bacteria is eliminated. Then the next thing in this beautiful graph that they did before we knew podunk about Bartonella is children. And so what they describe are children with granulomatous hepatitis, granulomatous splenitis, or adults that end up with not just localized granulomatous disease, but more generalized granulomatous disease. And that at the extreme is the AIDS patient that develops vasoproliferative lesion due to the fact that Bartonella induces hypoxia-inducible factor production of vascular endothelial growth factor by macrophages and makes endothelial cells proliferate like crazy. So the answer to your question, probably the other part that I would throw in there is absolutely the host immune response at the time in which this bacteria is injected or transfused through a blood transfusion is going to be absolutely critical as to whether a patent infection develops or the host eliminates the infection. If you dump Bartonella in transplant into a search, it's a little scary. Galaxy has a study with the University of Minnesota that's our first study, which is what we really want to be able to do as a company, is to support other studies, both in veterinary medicine and human medicine. But we are now looking at transplant recipients in regard to whether they had Bartonella before, during, or through blood transfusion. There's also a couple manuscripts under review from Brazil relative to using BAB-GM in screening blood donors. So that's kind of that part of it. If you look at the literature from South America, they believe that Bartonella baciliformis is an immunosuppressive infection, and that people with Bartonella baciliformis go on to get other infectious diseases, particularly mycobacterial diseases. In the laboratory, one of my PhD students, we put Bartonella vinsonii coli in dogs, and immunologically it suppresses several components of the cell-mediated humoral immune system.
Any final questions? Last one.
When we submit our samples for your PCR panel to the university and they come back as PCR negative, do they then automatically progress onto 16-day enrichment cultures, or is that not feasible?
Now, if they were submitted to like Galaxy Diagnostics or to LabCorp or Antech, that we're the only ones right now that's using this approach. So there's one laboratory in the world that's doing this commercially at this point, and it's the laboratory we started. Obviously, our goal is that there'll be laboratories all around the world offering this, and we've already talked to a couple people and trying to figure out how we can make that happen here in Australia.
But it is happening. They all proceed to enrichment culture if they're PCR negative.
No,
they don't.
None of them do.
No, in your laboratory.
Right, no. It, as a matter of fact, if you go to the IDEX website under Bartonella PCR, they will say that this PCR is not sensitive enough to detect Bartonella in most dogs, and they link to the Galaxy website and suggest enrichment culture for dogs, which, again, I've interacted and consulted with IDEX for years. And so I think it's very, I didn't ask them to put that in there, but it was very nice that he did. And I think it's because they're trying to be reputable and say, you know, this is what we can do. I mean, we've worked with rickettsias, ehrlichias, babesias, and I think most of the time, if you get a negative PCR there, it's likely a negative PCR. With Bartonella, a negative PCR doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I'd like to hand back to Professor Taylor to formally thank our lecturer.
Thank you very much, Professor Ward. Well, I think you'll have to agree with me. That was a really thought-provoking and arresting lecture. I can think of a million questions relevant to the health of veterinarians and our pets and our wildlife as well that I'd like to ask you. So it's really been a remarkable journey through these very important pathogens, and there's clearly a great deal more to be learnt out there, and I hope there'll be some students in the audience who'll be inspired to think about pursuing some research directions in this field in the future. But just before we finish, I'd like to say once again a very special thank you to Bayer Animal Health for helping to support Professor Breitschwerdt's international travel so he could be here with us tonight, and also to the group in the science events team who helped to put tonight together. Professor Michael Ward also assisted, Liz, Crystal and others, because an evening like tonight always requires quite a lot of coordination, and it's run very well, so thank you for that. But lastly, I'd like to say a very special thank you to Ed and for a great talk.
Thanks, Julian.
And that concludes the evening, so safe travels, and we hope to see you at our next Beveridge address. Thank you.